Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our panel event, Confronting Racism, Asian American History and Identity. Overcoming racism is a continual process of educating ourselves. So we're really grateful to learn from people who are further along in this journey and hear from these three wonderful individuals who have spent a good amount of time learning about racism and Asian American history. I know that a lot of you have been at the protests we've hosted the past several months in San Diego, and we're so excited that you're here today to continue this fight against racism that has been hurting the Asian American community, specifically recently in light of the coronavirus and the American outburst at it. So I think this event is really important because each of our personal experience is not the same as every other Asian American, especially for us. I know a lot of the audience is probably from San Diego, which is generally a better place in terms of hate crimes and inclusivity. And every time I hear about these historical stories, I'm always really surprised at how awful it was for people living 50 to 100 years ago. So this has opened so many new perspectives to me hearing about these stories. So I would like to introduce each of our three panelists. Thank you so much for coming here and speaking to us. Dr. Lei Guang is the So Family Executive Director of the 21st Century China Center at the UC San Diego School of Global Policy and Strategy. He was previously a professor of political science at San Diego State University and studied Chinese politics and U.S.-China relations. Professor Zhou is a Silicon Valley employee turned amateur historian. His research interests include Asian American history, immigration history, race and ethnicity, and the history of the American West. And last but definitely not least, we have Dr. Sun, who is a professor of history and the director of Asian studies at the University of San Diego. Her research interests include Sino-American relations and the history of Chinese women. So with that being said, I'd also like to say that our understanding of truth and history is always enriched by hearing from multiple perspectives. And this is just a friendly reminder to keep your ears open. Maybe your perspective will be drastically changed tonight by hearing about people from all across the country and across the decades. I'd like to give a huge thank you to my friend and fellow classmate, Abby Wu. She has helped us prepare, and I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Emily. I am a current senior at the Cambridge School and a rising freshman at Stanford, and I'm really excited to be hosting tonight. So with that being said, I'll go on to our first question. And I mentioned before everyone got here that we will have around 10 minutes for a Q&A from the audience at the end. So if you have any questions or comments, you can drop them into the Q&A. Abby will be responding to some of these questions and we'll be saving some for the panelists to address. So, all right, let's begin with question one. Are our panelists ready for that? Okay, great. So our title of this event is Confronting Racism, Asian American History and Identity. So what do these terms, what does Asian American identity and history mean to you? This is a very broad question, but why does history matter when we're talking about racism today?
I guess I'll go first. I'll make it very brief. And I think to me, it's really important for all of us to understand history because history informs us, enlightens us, and guides our actions. And the history of Asian Americans really goes back to the 19th century when the first wave of Chinese immigrants came to the United States. And currently Asian Americans are the fastest growing ethnic community in this country. Of course, Asian Americans mean more than Chinese Americans, as we know. I just wanna make briefly two points. One is that of diversity. So the Asian American population, extremely diverse. It includes immigrants, refugees, native born, and we're talking about second, third generations. We're also having very different socioeconomic backgrounds, education levels, with different culture heritage and historical legacies, not to mention differences in political persuasions. At the same time, though, I think I'd like to highlight the fact that we also share a great deal of commonalities. We value family, we value hard work, we invest in education, and historically, and very unfortunately, I think the Asian American identity has been forged by the common experience of having had to confront a very long legacy of exclusion and inequity, particularly during periods of economic recession, changing demographics, and war. So I'm just going to pause there, and perhaps Professor So can take it from here.
Thank you, Yi. First, let me thank We Impact for having me here. It's truly an honor for me to attend this event. And also it's a great opportunity for me to learn from two professors as well as the audience. As to the question, I think there's one thing I just want to emphasize here with regard to identity and history. To me, ethnic identity is not innate, but a social and historical concept. I like the way one historian put it. He says that one is not born an Asian American, one becomes an Asian American. What it really means is that ethnic identity as a concept is constructed. It's constructed over time. While naturally, some people may say that culture and traditions are defining characteristics of ethnic identity, they tend to assume that cultural traditions are simply inherited. To some degree, yes. However, culture can not only be inherited, but also be modified, and oftentimes even been invented. This will become more obvious when we begin to talk about such pan-ethnic groups as African Americans, Native Americans, Latinos, and Asian Americans. So my emphasis today here is simply that ethnic identity is more of a political and social process that is dynamic and keeps evolving. So that's just my quick point.
Well, let me also chime in. I think it's a good place for me to pick up here. Hal was really talking about identity as a group, a collective identity. So maybe I can reflect a bit more about how, as individuals, we relate to that, right? Actually, just before this, maybe 20 minutes ago, I looked up the word identity in the dictionary, the Oxford Dictionary, right? It defines the identity as the fact of being who or what a person or thing is. It's very simple. So we all are given a name at birth. That is, in a way, our identity, our individual identity. As we grew up, we become a brother, a sister, high school student, scientist, a politician. We acquire other identities along the way. That means our individual identities keep changing at different times in our lifetime. You know, one aspect or another assumes greater importance for us. So in a way, identity is all about individuals, but it's also connected to the society as a whole, as Hal was trying to articulate. So in other words, without something called a K-12 educational system, right, there will not be an identity of high school student for you to assume, right? Just, so now we come to a point where suddenly for many of us, the Asian American identity looms pretty large. There are reasons for this, and I hope the panel will get into that. But for me, for each of us as individuals, so I think it's best to think about identity as a way of relating to the society as a whole. So identity is important, but it's not exclusive. So your Asian American identity is one of many identities you can and should assume. So don't be afraid of asserting your Asian American identity while losing your other identities, because you won't, as an American, as a conservative even, right? That's point number one. So don't think that because you are active in the Asian American movement and assertive of American Asian American identity, then somehow you are alienated from the other groups. The second, you know, I'm a political scientist, and I, you know, identity in the political sense is often more important, you know, to the collective than for the individual. A collective without a clear group identity for its members risks being forgotten or ignored, right? So then there will be a sheet of sand, their voices won't be heard. So that we are at a point where the voices of Asian Americans are becoming louder and louder. That's a good thing. That means politically speaking, this particular community, this collective is discovering its influence in the American political process. So I just want to make these two points that, you know, identity is not exclusive and group identity is terribly important for the community as a whole.
Thank you so much for your answers. Yeah, I mean, Asian Americans are really diverse with common values, and we're defined by a multitude of colorful identities and terms. So my second question is, how did the group term of Asian American come about historically? And I'm talking about how did we change the term from Orientals to Asian American, and more importantly, what type of cultural change did that affect?
Let me try to get this question answered first. I think there are multiple factors contributing to the emergence and development of Asian American as an identity. But let me just quickly mention two, I believe, important factors. They're overlapping with each other. The first one, I think, is the rise of ethnic consciousness. Early Asian immigrants, they never thought of themselves as Asians. Rather, they thought of themselves as people from simply from Kaiping, Taishan, their villages, cities, you know, in Guangdong, in China, or from Hiroshima, Japan, or from Manila. Before World War II, these Asian groups, they were predominantly foreign-born and living largely in their respective ethnic enclaves. Therefore, they have very little interactions with each other as well as the larger society. While in the 1940s, native-born Asian Americans began to outnumber foreign-born immigrants. Ultimately, the war changed everything, allowing the rising younger generation the opportunity to participate in the mainstream American economy and society. Same language, direct contact with each other, as well as larger society, made them realize that they share common struggles and aspirations. And they also became more identified with the United States. When we get into 1960s, the social and political struggles against the racism, poverty, sexism, and the war made people realize that they have to actively pursue their collective interests. Actually, they can do that by bonding together. The civil rights movement, particularly the Black Power movement and the anti-war movement, set in motion the Asian American movement and other ethnic minority movements. In this movement, the rise of ethnic consciousness and pride were deeply rooted in their perceived common experience and history that involved common racial subjugation. The then prevailing term that Emily mentioned, Oriental, usually suggests submission and passivity, gradually gave way to a new term, Asian American, that connotes inclusion and equality. So the new term began to become popular in the 1970s among social scientists and scholars and social activists who continue to push for electoral politics, as well as the development of ethnic studies programs in US universities and colleges. So I would say this is the first strand of force that gave rise to the identity. Well, second, and has a lot to do with the state power. Non-Asian groups in this country had little understanding of various ethnic groups from Asia. You can see that from the exclusion laws in the 19th and 20th centuries, they normally treated Asians as homogeneous, right? So the post-civil rights era, redefined and expanded ethnic minority rights from equal individual opportunities to equitable distribution of group rights. In this process, the state institutionalized ethnicity in government programs. One obvious example is affirmative action programs. The program lumped diverse racial and ethnic minority groups into four large categories. You know, African Americans, Native Americans, Hispanics, Latinos, and Asian Americans. So on the one hand, programs need to get approved and funding, they have to be based on such large categories. While on the other hand, those who want to claim benefits would have to conform to such categorization as well. Another simple example would be the US Census. That's been conducted by the state. That means the state also plays an important role in shaping the boundaries of ethnic groups. So those are the two forces I think that are important for the formation and development of Asian American as an ethnic identity.
Thank you so much, Professor Zhou. Yeah, the term Asian American was truly a gigantic step forward from Orientals, which seems to be a term really rooted in exoticism and kind of the uniqueness of Asian Americans from other Americans. But unfortunately, the same problem is still there in that Asian Americans are still seen as homogenous from outsiders. I know I've gotten this comment multiple times, like, are you Korean, Japanese, Chinese? I can't tell the difference. It's very disrespectful. So how do we kind of understand diversity in the unity that is the group of Asian Americans? And moreover, there is conflicts between the groups in the Asian American community. You know, right now there's tensions between Taiwan and China, and decades earlier there were leftover sentiments from World War II, and that created a lot of division as well. So my question once again is, how do we understand conflict between constituent groups, and how do we find this unity in diversity?
Well, you, Emily, it's funny that you brought up the Taiwan and China question. That's actually a good point to illustrate this point about the diversity in terms of experiences. And I would like to tell the story of one experience of mine when I was in graduate school and studying political science, you know, studying Chinese politics. And I, at that time, the Taiwanese politics was undergoing tremendous change, and the opposition party DPP came to power. The vice president, Lynette Lu Xiulian, actually came to Minnesota and give a talk. So I thought, oh, this is great. And, you know, I can go and hear her talk in Chinese and just get to know what DPP is all about. But it wasn't until I went there, I realized that I was so out of place, because the entire talk was conducted in Fujianese. I did not understand at all. And all these people there, I don't recognize any of these people. And Minnesota does not have a huge, quote unquote, Chinese community, right? So we have to come to this recognition that Asian American community, including the more narrowly defined Chinese American community, is very diverse. We should think about identity and diversity together, and not as opposites, right? I'm just stopping, you know, as Sing Yi mentioned at the beginning, just think about for a moment about the diversity in the Asian American community. For the first generation immigrants, it contains, you know, many different groups and cohorts, you know, with very complex and different migration routes and past and present histories. You know, we come to the US from different countries with different national cultures and political experiences. Our ancestors fought each other. Japanese against the Koreans, Chinese against the Vietnamese, Chinese against Chinese, Buddhists against Hindus, right? And how can one expect that we simply bury the hatches and they unite? It will take a long time, maybe in a couple of generations and a lot of work by all of us. But you know, for the second later generations, and I think that we can count probably sixth generations of Chinese right now. I probably know a you know, one or two of these Chinese in who live in the US. The diversity is also equally vast, right? Inequality among the Asians has grown the fastest. I read some time ago that of all the different Asian and racial and ethnic groups in America since 1970, Asian Americans, inequality within the Asian Americans. Right now, the 10% the top income earners have 10 times more than the bottom 10% of the income earners among the Asian Americans. 10, 10, 10, right? That's a number easy to remember. So the economic interests cannot be similar. So why then, you ask, is it still important to assert an Asian American this identity, right? I think to me, the more important reason for doing that is to join the forces that are already out there to strive for a more equitable America, a more just society, because Asian American community itself is going through this change and inequality and all this. So it's maybe as much about taking pride in our own cultural heritage and culture as it is about taking pride in the diversity and in giving equal voices to all these different people. I think that would be the way to go. That's just my thought and reflection on this question of, you know, how do we deal with this diversity of, you know, interests and experiences and identity.
Yeah, thank you for your thoughts, Dr. Guang. So we have so many intergroup differences, but solidarity is still so real and meaningful. And part of that is that it's built upon shared experiences and collective interests. But unfortunately, one of those shared experiences is racism and anti-Asian violence. So I would love to hear some of your thoughts about the recent anti-Asian violent incidents. And do you think they were perpetuated by individuals, or are they a result of general racism that is embedded within society? For a lot of us, it's really difficult to think about our elders getting hurt and our friends being scared. So we search for closure, and we would like to believe that these acts are just carried on by individuals who are very much unique from society, instead of something that has come as a result of society's racism over time.
Let me jump into this one, talking about the historical pattern of anti-Asian violence. Historians and scholars have documented so many of those kind of instances throughout the American history. The anti-Asian violence we are experiencing today is really systemic. It fits into a pattern that's deeply rooted in our country's history. The history really goes back to mid-19th century, when the first group of Asian immigrants, particularly the Chinese, arrived in California for the gold rush, as well as the construction of the Transcontinental Railroad. As many of you have read the stories. There are many factors driving this kind of recurring pattern. Let me just quickly mention a few. The first one, economy. The Asian immigrants often became easy scapegoats during time of heightened economic anxiety, whether it's in the form of declining wages or a large scale of unemployment, particularly among white Americans. Unfortunately, 1870s and 1880s saw frequent economic problems in this country, particularly in the American West. And this is the time that we saw the heightened anti-Asian violence, particularly against the Chinese in both urban and rural areas. Just a very quick few examples that many of you may have already heard. In 1871, there are mobs in Los Angeles lynching 17 Chinese immigrants. In 1885, 28 Chinese workers were massacred in Rock Spring, Wyoming. Right, so those are in the 19th centuries. If you fast forward moving into the 20th century, we probably heard people talking about in the 1980s, the anti-Asian racism resurged again because of the economic recessions in this country, as well as the US trade tensions with Japan, as well as the backlash of the so-called modern minority stereotypes, right, in the public media. They all drove violence against Asians. The most consequential case during that period was the killing of Vincent Chen, as many of you know, in 1982. So I will stop here for the first factor. Secondly, though, I think social fears also drive violence. In the early 1900s, the Japanese replaced the Chinese as the major source of cheap labor, particularly in the American West. Unlike the Japanese were able to brought over Japanese women. So they were able to form families in America. Unfortunately, the ability for the Japanese to form families make American whites so concerned that they worry about the racial purity of this country. Therefore, the Japanese faced frequent violence in the West Coast, particularly in San Francisco. Another example, just in a couple of decades, when all Asian laborers were barred from entering this country, only the Filipinos, because they were American nationals in the 1930s, they became the source of cheap labor. However, driven by the concerns of interracial mixing, as well as the challenge of the economy at that time, the mobs began to attack the Filipinos. So there was famous cases in Watsonville, which is a town in the south of San Jose. There are 4 days of rioting. One people got killed and many got beaten. And the rioting spread over into the San Jose area. So this is what the social fears can do with regard to anti-Asian violence. Lastly, let me quickly touch upon another factor, which is political anxiety. Well, when we talk about this, people often remember during World War II, the Japanese, right? 120,000 Japanese, they were just forcefully being relocated and incarcerated in internment camps without due process. 2/3 of them were native-born American citizens. While in the 1990s, some politically active Asian Americans, they became targets again of racially charged investigation with regard to alleged campaign financing abuse in the Clinton campaign. Yes, a few of them committed illegal acts. However, the entire Asian American community was subjected to racial profiling. The level of political stigmatization was unseen since McCarthyism in the 1950s. Lastly, let me just quickly mention 9/11. Well, in the aftermath of 9/11, throughout this country, hate crimes against Muslim, Middle Eastern, and South Asian Americans increased by 16-fold, while Sikh Americans remained as target of racial violence, as we just saw the killing in Indianapolis. So let me stop here. Many of the incidents I just mentioned fit into the historical pattern of anti-Asian American discrimination as well as violence.
Thank you, Dr. Zhou. Yeah, I think this discussion of systemic racism is so, so important. And I'll continue this discussion in this next question. Let's focus on the government specifically. What types of laws, rules, and regulations have they put in place that contributed to the persistence and relevance of anti-Asian racism in the United States?
Emily, that's such a really important question. And Hao has highlighted some of the major racist incidences, including violent ones against different groups of Asian Americans throughout history. Unfortunately, that kind of sentiment, or even to some extent violence, still will continue today. If we look at the sort of how the government, the US government has responded to the anti-Asian sentiment and activities in history, unfortunately, we're also seeing a pattern. Talking about, you know, historians are into historical patterns. So it seemed to me, whenever there was widespread public sentiment, discrimination, and violence against Asian Americans, the US government would almost invariably enact a piece of legislation excluding or minimizing or marginalizing immigration from Asian countries. I won't have time to go through all the pieces of legislation, obviously, but let's talk about a few. Like, for instance, a lot of people know about the 1882 Chinese Exclusion Act, which is probably the most infamous one. However, probably fewer people know about the 1875 Page Act as sort of a precursor to the Chinese Exclusion Act 7 years down the road. Some scholars have recently argued perhaps a seed of the Atlanta shooting can be traced back to this Page Act, because just to, you know, I gotta simplify it a little bit. So what it did in essence was targeting all Chinese female immigrants in this country. So in other words, it treated all Chinese women who were here at that point as prostitutes. After that, when there were Chinese women who were trying to gain entry into the United States, they had to prove at point of entry that they were not prostitutes. So you can imagine that kind of sexualization of Chinese women was harmful, but it was also effective at that point, because the immigration of Chinese women to the United States just plummeted after the Page Act. And other scholars have also argued the real purpose behind that was to really limit the natural reproduction of Chinese American population in this country. And then after that, we talked about the 1882 Chinese Exclusion Act. Howe has laid out sort of the background for that. After the Chinese laborers made immense contributions to the Continental Railroad construction, they were ironically blamed for taking jobs away from the white laborers who now, through the railroad, through the better transportation system, found their way to the West Coast. So anti-Chinese violence raged throughout the West Coast. We're not even talking about the local level. So again, I won't go through all of them. And then 1908, there was anti-Japanese regulation reached with the Japanese government. And then 10 years after that, in 1917, there was a so-called Pacific Barred Zone Act that was targeting Indian immigrants. They were labeled as the Hindu invasion. And so that act outlawed immigration from India. So then 1924, I think most people probably know about this one, that immigration act was directed exclusively at Asian immigrants. It fully excluded Asian immigrants from Asian countries, denied citizenship and naturalization of those who were here, and prevented them from marrying Caucasians or even owning land. And it's interesting that Howe mentioned about the Filipinos who are sort of excluded from these anti-Asian legislation, because the Philippines was a US colony after 1898. But Congress came up with a very clever solution. So they promised the Philippines, the Filipinos, that they would gain independence in 1946. In doing so, it made the Filipino immigrants eligible for Exclusion Act. So there. And again, Howe talked about the internment of Japanese Americans after Pearl Harbor. So really, even early 1950s, there was another new immigration act. It relaxed a little bit, but still was highly discriminatory against Asian immigrants. Really giving 100 visas per year to one Asian country, which is not exactly fair or equitable. So it really wasn't until the 1965 Immigration Act when Asians for the first time could enter this country in large numbers and also as families. And later on, due to the American eagerness for technology during the Cold War, foreign engineers and scientists were also encouraged to emigrate to the United States. So, I mean, the history of legislative acts enacted by Congress is long and largely negative towards Asian immigration and immigrants. So I'll just pause here because I can go on forever.
Well, maybe I can chime in just with a couple of words. You know, I think it's great to be among the historians because, you know, that they can just give you, if you think about, okay, Asian Americans today, you think about the US American society today, one tendency for many of us is to say, it is to take whatever is here as a given, right? That's the starting point. But they usually don't probe deeper and longer back into the history. And once you start doing that, you discover all the skeletons and all the, you know, bad things that happened. And then you probably can come to some reasonably conclusions about why things are they are today, right? I mean, because as political scientists, we think about systemic a little differently, you know, but even just by counting the number of incidences that have been taken place in recent years, you know, that in itself is one way of establishing the widespread or systemic nature of it, right? I remember reading a report that was issued by the CSU Long Beach. They have this anti-Asian hate crime report. They documented the number of anti-Asian hate crimes and instances in the past year, basically since the start of the COVID and the beginning, the first quarter of this year. And in some of the largest cities like New York City, Los Angeles, San Francisco, where there are a lot of Asian Americans congregate, the instances have gone up, you know, 100% and 200%. And actually San Diego has done remarkably well in that particular statistic. I'm not sure whether that's because people are not reporting or because the official registrar is not paying attention. I don't know, but I found that to be still, you know, San Diego is an outlier, but if you look at these large cities where there are a lot of Asian immigrants, Asian Americans, you see that increasing greatly.
Yeah, thank you for those answers, Dr. Sun and Dr. Guan. The sad thing about it is that racism from the government and racism from the people seems to be kind of like a chicken and egg cycle. One perpetuates the other and then the other incentivizes the other to keep on continuing. So my next question is about systemic racism from society's point of view. What are some of these ideologies that have perpetuated xenophobia that have been deeply ingrained into American history? I know we had a question about the model minority myth. So I would love to hear from all three of our panelists. What are your thoughts about that?
Any one of you wants to start or?
I can get it started. I'll make it again brief. I think we're in the interest of time. I think if you're talking about the ideology or ideologies, one of them is probably nativism, which really has fueled anti-Asian racism ever since historically and contemporarily, because we are an easily identifiable ethnic group just because of the way we look. You know, Asians are seen and treated as a perpetual alien who are not assimilable to the American society, especially, I guess, in historical terms. So as a result, it's easy to blame anything negative or dangerous on someone foreign, right? For instance, one thing that comes to mind, I'll just mention that a lot of people may not know about this, and that is in 1900 in San Francisco, there was the outbreak of the bubonic plague. And guess what? The Chinese in Chinatown were squarely blamed for that. They were called all sorts of names, and a couple of quotations came to mind. They were called a social, moral, and political curse to the community. They were called lying, treacherous Chinamen, you know, in all these derogatory terms. So they were forcefully removed and their houses fumigated and their cases, you know, their illness not treated, resulting actually in 119 deaths out of 121 cases. So, you know, you see the sort of the connection and legacy, unfortunately, even now. So it's easy and convenient to blame COVID on China and by extension, Chinese Americans. So I guess that's what I would want to mention.
Let me quickly chime in, add to what you just mentioned. I think the idea she mentioned about perpetual aliens, right? Asian Americans being unassimilable. The fundamental question underneath that idea is who is permitted to become Americans? Are Asian Americans permitted to ever to become American? So that's a fundamental question that everyone has to ponder, no matter how long we live in this country, right? Another thing related to this, I would like to mention is the idea of racial hierarchy, right? Even we are permitted into this nation, we often face a hierarchy. American society in terms of race relations is often seen as a hierarchy. Along this hierarchy, the Chinese, the Japanese, people from East Asia often were portrayed as something like hardworking. So every one of you probably experienced this, being portrayed as hardworking, high achieving in academics. At the same time, Asian Americans are rule abiding and uncomplaining. So thereby, we've been inserted into the hierarchy as often people call surrogate whites, right? We are honorary whites. We're not there yet, but we are better than other races. So this idea sounds positive. The positivity indeed has some empirical basis, as Lei mentioned earlier. Yes, the average, if you look at the average education level, the median income, household income of Asian Americans, we are very high. Nonetheless, this stereotype grossly misrepresented the diversity we just talked about of Asian American as a community. It also obscures the income inequality, right? Which they said is the highest among all racial groups. This kind of idea is very pernicious. It is pernicious in multiple ways, right? It imposes a single characterization on a community that's so diverse. And secondly, it just pits Asian American against other racial minorities who are often considered inferior to us. And so this is something creating enormous amount of racial conflicts. So this idea that we have to really think about the idea of racial hierarchy in relation to the stereotype of modern minorities of Asian Americans.
These are, you know, fascinating discussions that, you know, nativism, sort of modern minority, you know, this idea of a racial hierarchy. And we can all connect them in some ways to the politics, right? That for politicians that represent certain interests, these ideologies are very useful. Nativism certainly is a way to mobilize a particular constituency, right? To consolidate their support. And model minority myth is doing just the opposite trick, that is to demobilize another community, right? Telling them that actually you guys are doing pretty well, right? And the racial hierarchy is the classic strategy of divide and rule, right? So if you think about these ideologies and why would these ideologies have purchase or have usefulness, right? And you connect that to politics, you find that you know, that they are very useful. They serve a political purpose, quote unquote. Now, that brings me to this interesting point about political leadership, why it matters. Right? Recently, our center, a couple of economists actually at the center did an interesting study. They look at the rising frequency in the usage of racial slurs against the Chinese Americans during the pandemic and their association with the rise of hate crimes. Well, there have been past studies that show that there is a link. That is, you know, in a particular geographical area, the more, the higher the frequency of usage for words like chink, okay, the higher the instances against Asian or Chinese Americans, right? And in the pandemic, we saw that there has been a big increase. Why? One of the reasons is because the person in charge, right, our president, was up, you know, on the front line promoting this connection, right? And they found that every tweet by Trump that mentions COVID and China together led to about 20% jump in racially charged tweets nationwide in the 4 hours that follows, right? And then, in other words, and then they can even quantify what each additional tweet equals to about 8% increase in the offline anti-Asian hate incidents on the same day. Now, all these ideologies are useful, and politicians and political leadership does matter. And that's another reason why, you know, we are so happy to see this younger generation, people like Emily and Abby, they are stepping up and they are saying, hey, enough of that. We are here to assert that leadership. So that's important.
Those statistics are so startling and so upsetting. So I'm really happy that we're gathered here today to talk about what we can do to fix this. So this is my last question. Hopefully we can make this one a little brief because I see so many awesome questions coming in the Q&A function. This question is a call to action. What can our audience members today do to make a change?
Well, you know, as I just mentioned, I think, you know, forums and educational forums like this is a great start. But you also, if the audience take note, right, that the Asian American community have been more active than ever that I have, you know, seen in the past 20 some years that I've lived in this country in organizing, right? The national, there's a national Asian Pacific American Bar Association that organizes attorneys who have set up a hate crime resources where people can report hate crimes, right? The Asian American Foundation that was just created a few days ago, a few weeks ago, you know, receiving hundreds of millions of dollars of pledge that to support a range of programming for in Asian America, because what they found was some of these people who were active in this, I know them, that they, in the past, the amount of foundation funding for Asian American groups was less than 1%. So they wanted to correct that. So that kind of organizing by Asian Americans together, I think that's going to make a difference. That's what, you know, everybody should be doing. And
Sven. Yeah, just a quick point. I think it's critical for us together to keep explore and ponder the meaning and the development of Asian American identity so that we understand the importance of why we need to unite, need to understand the importance of unity, not just between ourselves as Asian Americans, but also cross the racial line with other minority groups. While at the same time, we should also be conscious of our differences so that we understand intra-community as well as inter-community divisions and even conflicts sometimes. Mm-hmm. After all, no group is immune to biases and hate. So that we just need to study this thing and making sure that we know where we are in terms of our perception of our own identity.
That's really, I mean, well put, and I echo a lot of the things that Lei and Hao have said. And again, it circles back to the fact that we as a community, we need to acknowledge our diversity as well as our commonality and embrace with pride and dignity our cultural heritage and celebrate our contributions. Asian Americans have done a ton to contribute to in this country economically and otherwise. And also in the meanwhile, insist on our shared identity as Americans. And specifically, you know, I jotted down a few things, and we need to be more educated, right? So this is one of the things that we can do to kind of really get ourselves more educated and more enlightened on this topic about the history and the culture, collective experiences of Asian Americans, and also become more energized. I think we should no longer be sitting on the sidelines and waiting for others or to benefit from others' hard work. And finally, to become more engaged, make our due contributions, attend rallies, make donations, and do whatever we can. Participate in the entire political process as active citizens, not as passive observers. We also, I think, maybe one final point, something as simple as let your classmates and friends know that US-China relations or this competition is not a zero-sum game. In many ways, you know, a rationality or rational approaches to foreign policy making should prevail on both sides. I think right now, Sino-American relations is really impacting on how Chinese Americans, and again, by extension, all Asian Americans are treated. So those are some of the thoughts that I have in mind. Thank you.
All right, great. We have so many awesome questions. I've been chatting with Abby here. We'll try our best. If we can't answer your question live, she will try to chat in response. I really like this question. Is the increase in anti-Asian sentiment related to the fall of the American economy and the rise of China?
I can take a stab at that question. Okay, the first answer I want to give is not so much for two reasons. One is the anti-Asian violence and et cetera is directed at the broader Asian community, not just the Chinese community, right? Although Chinese probably bore the brunt of it. The other part is that, you know, the study that I refer to that was published on our China Data Lab website actually explicitly looked at that question. And they found that in the, you know, racial slurs did not increase appreciably in areas with more severe economic damage from the COVID. And in other words, it, you know, those areas did not exhibit a larger increase in the racial slurs than the areas with less severe impact. Rather, what they found was the language calling this a China virus actually made a difference. So that's two. But I hate, you know, I would not, I'm a political scientist, but I think economy is pretty important, that economy does impact people's thinking. So I wouldn't, you know, there have been studies that shows that not so much about the rise of China, but the specific China shock. In other words, the way that the China trade has impacted certain communities that made the political environment in that particular community more polarized. So that enabled the election of more conservative. So in other words, in some of these communities, some of our colleagues' study found was in congressional districts, right? That the districts that experienced their largest layoffs or negative changes impacts under the China trade, they become more polarized. So it will become, you know, in the congressional elections. So they send to Congress, you know, members who are on the extreme sides. So in that sense, it contributed not so much the rise of China, but the impact of China on the US economy has contributed to the polarization in the American political system. Let me just stop there.
Okay, yeah, thank you so much. I think we are going to go a couple minutes over time because there are too many fascinating questions. If you need to go now, Abby will send a link in chat to a document to a lot of resources you can use to continue to educate yourself. And I will go on with the next audience question. Do we still need to keep the term Asian Americans? Can we just be Americans now? I know that this one is especially applicable to second, third, fourth generation Asian Americans.
Let me quickly touch upon this. I think one aspect of the answer can come from what I mentioned earlier, that one of the important reasons for the emergence and development of Asian American as an ethnic identity is the force of the state, right? The state created certain programs, certain narratives that categorize the people into specific groups. Often this kind of categorization denotes type of racial discrimination. While sometimes it's in the interest of resolving some of the historical racial discriminations, nonetheless, it creates a categorization. I think the reason that we need to stick to this type of identity is an important way for us to combat, right, the imposition of the force that incurs, that brought about discrimination against us. So as a political force, I think this identity is very, very important for us to mobilize, for us to resist. I think that's my quick point.
And I would agree. And I think in an ideal world, we should all be referred to as Americans. You know, the half-native references are not exactly what we want, but the reality is such that I think it actually is probably at this particular point would serve the Asian American community well to at least accept that identification, if not embrace it. And the Senate in late April just passed a bill. I think it's still waiting for the House to do something about that. It's not a law yet, but it's a bill that's directly sort of safeguarding Asian Americans' interests. It's against anti-Asian hate crimes. So that, as far as I know, was the first one in US history that's specifically expressing or articulating the idea that Asian Americans, if they are on the receiving end of hate crimes, the perpetrators should be dealt accordingly, should be dealt with accordingly. So I think personally, at this point, it's probably a productive way of dealing with the current realities in the US?
Well, my answer to that question was quite simple, that because that question assumes that there's some kind of a, you know, either or, American or Asian American. As I mentioned, that we all take on different identities, and it doesn't mean that you cannot be an American by asserting your Asian American community identity. But more importantly is to think about Asian American identity issues in terms of how you can be part of a broader movement to bring about a more equitable society that will be fair and just, not just to Asian Americans, but to everybody.
All right, thank you. I think we're going to answer maybe 2 to 3 more questions. I like this question because it's along with the theme of history today. It's from Mr. Mueller. Hi, Mr. Mueller. Which discriminatory laws or practices are still in play today? And how do they impact the diverse groups within the AAPI designation differently?
Uh, Let me jump into this question a little bit. Please chime in, Yi and Lei. I think largely thanks to previous generations' activism and progressive actions, explicit racism expressed in American laws and regulations have fortunately largely gone, right? So, which is great. On the other hand, American racism has evolved in the way that racism against Asian Americans become less blunt. Actually, it becomes pretty insidious. In that way, it probably becomes more perilous. So racism against Asian Americans, setting structural barriers for Asian Americans to gain equality and fairness in this country, is not just in a way of laws and regulations, but also particularly in the current environment, in the forms of ideas, ideologies, biases, and stereotypes. And we touch upon quite a few of those, right? So, so I will stop here to let Yi and Lei tackle the second part. I think there's a second part of the question, right?
So Yi, you want
I think
you want
I agree with exactly what Hao had just said. I think when I sort of rattled off the whole list of immigration acts that were targeting exclusively Asian American immigration and immigrants, fortunately, in 1965, those old laws were replaced, right? But one thing I think we all have to realize is the fact that we owe a great deal of debt to the civil rights movement, without which there would not have been the 1965 Immigration Act, without which many of us may not have been able to come here. So I think that's important for us to realize as well. And as Hao is saying, even though the legalized discrimination and racism has been replaced, racism in terms of sentiment based on economic pretext or social forces, cultural prejudices are still quite pervasive.
I agree that that maybe, you know, it's important to make this distinction and then and also to assert that the abolition of legal discrimination on the books kind of discrimination doesn't mean that the practice of discrimination will end. We all know that, you know, slavery was abolished, you know, 150 years ago, right? And if it were not for the civil rights movement, we will probably would not even be here, right? So the formal act of legislation certainly helps. And we see that, that even now in Congress, they are passing anti-Asian hate crime bills. So that's a step forward, that's progress. But at the same time, as you know, as you guys, I don't know whether you guys are aware of this, that that currently, for example, there has been a lot of attention paid to what the Justice Department is doing under a particular initiative called the China Initiative. Now, what that started under Trump, and they are targeting a lot of the Chinese American scientists and researchers and entrepreneurs. Now, they probably have formal legal, clearance to do all that, but the, you know, if you look at how the program is carried out, how what kind of, that you found that you will find that that is really a ill-conceived, and you might want to say, you know, very Chinese-targeted initiative that smacks of racism. So formal laws, you know, I think we're moving forward, right? The actual practices, we maybe are reproducing a lot of what happened in the history.
And let me just quickly add one more thing, and that is, you know, leadership, as Leigh pointed out early on, and rhetoric, and the perception that's generated by the media and everybody else, you know, in between, really go a long way in sort of greenlighting and perpetuating this anti-Asian racism. One of the ways that it's manifested is, aside from the China initiative that Leigh just talked about, is the fact that Asian American diplomats in the State Department, for instance, they're the ones who have to cross a higher bar in terms of security clearance. And there's a long delay in their gaining their security clearance. Last thing I read not too long ago was the fact that 306 Asian American diplomats have filed grievances and complaints to the new Secretary of State, saying basically they are not, it's impossible for them to get a diplomatic post in the country where their culture heritage seems to be derived from. For instance, a Korean American diplomat who was born here and again, full-fledged American, guess what? It's impossible for him to get a post to in South Korea because of that perceived cultural affinity. And that doesn't apply to other ethnic groups from you know, other countries, immigrants or native born. So I just want to add that one other point.
All right. We'll probably have time for one more question live. So if there's any questions in the Q&A box that panelists, you have some thoughts on, feel free to go ahead and answer it. Our last question of today is, what can we do to escape the scapegoating of Asian Americans that has been happening during COVID times?
Could you repeat that question, Emily? Sorry.
Yeah, sure, no worries. What can we do to escape being the victims of scapegoating? It's specifically in response to the coronavirus.
Solidarity, I think. We cannot win it just by particular grievances that are particular to our group. I think we have to be part of, that's why I'm saying we have to be part of movement to make America a better place for everyone. So, and then all these resources that are being made available, I think would help, you know, now there are, you know, because calling it out, that's a good step to start. You know, this Asian American resource centers, right? We see, and you know, they are being set up, foundations, Committee 100, you know, that's preeminent of Chinese American organization that's been doing a lot of work in this area. And what we see, because I work at the China Center here, so, and I'm in touch frequently with a lot of people in these organizations, there has been a major pivot toward, sort of Chinese American community programming, right? Even we, you know, I actually was involved in a project that tries to highlight the Chinese American contribution to innovation in America, right? So I think through all these different strands of efforts, I think we will make a difference. That's my hope, my maybe misplaced optimism. What about you and Han and Yi, what do you think?
I guess I'll repeat what I said briefly early on, and that is one thing that distinguishes Asian Americans' collective experiences is the fact that there's always this connection on a foreign policy front as well, much more so than how immigrants or people of other ethnic groups are faring. So one thing perhaps we could do is to again, to impress upon your friends, your classmates, and whoever that you could share your view with, and that is really Chinese Americans and Asian Americans as a whole have nothing to do with foreign policy making, right? So there should be that kind of meaningful separation. And just because there is this gathering animosity towards the Chinese government and China in general, that shouldn't be reflected so negatively and perniciously on experiences of Asian Americans here.
Yeah, let me just quickly, a couple points. I echo that we have to unite, we have to build solidarity. But in order to do that effectively, we need to understand the root cause of what we are facing, right? This is something deeper than we think. We have to realize that we have to confront the racial reality, which is that Asian American faces racial discriminations in different forms in our current situation, right? We just cannot turn our head away from this reality and just pretend that this is already a colorblind society. No, this is far away from that. So this is only understanding this point can we be united and work together to make an ideal American society.
That's a positive note to end on, Hao.
Yep, I'm positive.
It really is. Professors, do you have maybe like an email address you can leave in the chat for anyone who wants to follow up with further questions?
Of course.
Sure.
Thank you so much. And yeah, Abby put the document of resources once again in the chat. The session was just so encouraging to listen to. I learned so much, and also all of the questions that came in were great. We're so happy that people are getting involved in history and asking these very, very important considerations. I think one thing that history has shown is that solidarity between races is just as important. Finding allies in other oppressed minorities is just such a powerful move. And I think that's so relevant for people today. Just a couple weeks ago when I was protesting, I loved seeing all of the non-Asians who were out there protesting and supporting us. So if that's one thing history has shown, we really need to unite together and not just within the Asian American community. So thank you so much to everyone who's come, and also congratulations. I think learning about a very painful topic is difficult, and coming here is an awesome first step to achieving a better society and world where life is more just and equal, and we obviously have so much further to go. So thank you everyone. I hope you have a great Sunday. And thank you so much to Abby, who has been doing a great job of manning the Q&A box. Abby has a calligraphy account where she posts a lot about social justice as well, and she wants to study Asian American studies at Berkeley next year. So Abby, if you feel comfortable, maybe people, if you have questions for someone of a younger generation, maybe you can direct them to Abby's account as well.
Great. Well, thank you, Emily and Abby, for organizing, for bringing us together and organizing such a timely topic. I learned a lot and I'm super impressed.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Really appreciate it.
Congratulations, Emily, to you and Abby and everybody else who is here. So thank you all for being here.